Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back after a short break. You're watching Towards the Origin. And tonight's topic for discussion is human desire, in conversation with Shaykh Kazi Lutfur Rahman, who is the respected Imam and Khateeb of Regent's Park Mosque. Sheikh, you ended on a very important note, which I really wanted to touch upon after the and in this segment, which is you have mentioned, as Quran clearly mentioned, that people follow their human desires, or human follow their own desires, and miss even the fara'id, the salah, the most fundamental pillar of Islam.
Correct.
Now, I want to touch upon a subject which is clearly, I can see, and we can all see now, Ramadan has just passed.
Yep.
We have seen, alhamdulillah, all the masajid, alhamdulillah, across the UK and Europe, or even in any part of the world, have been full of worshippers, full of dedicated worshippers. And as soon as we have seen Ramadan finished,
yep,
Shawwal entered, after the Eid, now the masjid feels like it's calling its worshippers to come.
That's
and pray.
Right, yep.
And we see it's completely empty.
That's right.
Now, as if like the importance of Jama'ah is only during Ramadan and it's not outside Ramadan.
Yes.
And unfortunately, we have also seen people who don't normally pray, but in Ramadan, they become a regular Musalli. Mm. And after Ramadan, somehow, I don't know, or we don't know, the Salah, the importance of Salah, even not in Jama'ah, even on their own, vanishes.
That's right. That's
How
right.
do we make sure that it's not only in Ramadan and after Ramadan we should continue our salah?
We did mention again and again, and we, as many imams and speakers and ulama, they speak and they remind people that salah is not just for Ramadan. Salah is so important that it's considered as the second most important pillar in Islam. This is the only pillar which was instructed or which is commanded by Allah the Almighty in a special meeting in the story in the event of Mi'raj, Isra wal Mi'raj. Remember we spoke.
Yes, indeed.
So Salah is so important that one of the scholars said, I can't imagine a Muslim without Salah. So how can we miss prayers and we still claim to be Muslims? And even some scholars, they said, some imams of Islam, they said that if someone deliberately misses Salah, he may go out of the fold of Islam. However, this is not the mainstream opinion, but this is one of the opinions of a great imam of Islam. Now, and people need to really think about it.
No, that's very, very true. And Salah does not even literally take our time. If we see the amount of things that we do in our life.
It's spiritual nourishment. It's food for our soul.
Correct.
So unless we pray Salah, how can we find peace in our day-to-day life? Without Salah, nothing falls in correct routine. Nothing falls in...
And people who especially, I think people who normally pray all their five daily prayers, they notice there's a difference, especially, you know, when you pray the faraid, especially the fajr with Jama'ah. You see there's a difference. You see how the day runs about.
Exactly. That's true.
Now, just to slightly brief again to touch upon this, on the salah aspect. Now, also we do notice that some are negligent. They say, we have the intention to pray, but they're not praying. But they say, we have the intention to pray.
To pray, yeah.
Now, how does they say, they use the common hadith that we say, innama al-amalu bin niyat.
Yeah. No. Niyah has to be accompanied with actions. Okay. Now, in Islam, we have niyah. Yeah, niyah is important. Intention is important. But that doesn't make actions any insignificant in any way. So amal is Islam is belief and amal and actions.
So it's basically like, I can't have the intention of being a student if I'm not enrolled at any university or college.
Yes, that's right.
Great. Now, I just wanted to move into a little bit of our topic of human desire. Now, we see as human beings, as I've mentioned in my first segment, that part of the human desire is the love, the crave for fame, for name, for preeminence,
which
for
spoke
power,
last week.
For
leadership.
And we have spoken last week, but slightly want to touch a little bit more detail into it.
Yeah.
Now, as Muslim, we all know that what is accepted and what's not. Allah has given us this, at least this sort of capacity to understand the difference between right and wrong.
Mm.
Now, many a times we unintentionally fall into the trap of this love of power, fame, or name, or
leadership. Authority, excessive
and
love.
And sometimes it's too much difficult to come back from that track because we might have exceeded that threshold.
Mm, yes.
Now, how does one identifies himself or herself before actually going too far or before becoming a slave of their own desire, if I can use that word?
Now, you said the right thing. We can really relate the issue of excessive love for fame and status and authority as we discussed last week. And now, there are some of the symptoms which are outlined by our scholars, and especially the scholars who are experts in spirituality. So they said the symptoms of desires can be found in certain people. So number one, they said, al-ujbu bin nafs, someone who has a lot of self-importance. So he feels or she feels that she's really important, and she presents or he presents himself as an important individual. And then also you see that person will praise himself, or person will praise herself a lot.
Excessive self-praising.
Oh, I've done this, I've done that. Now, sharing a good news, it's not something bad in Islam, but excessively, again and again, talking about it, that can be a symptom of love for being famous or being important, someone who is taken or considered to be important in society. Also, as we said, some people, they love certain titles. If they're not called that those titles, they easily get upset. So if they're not called, for example, Shaykh, or they're not called Allama, or they're not called Mufti or Doctor or Engineer, certain titles that they want to be, as soon as someone doesn't call, then they just be upset.
I mean, let's narrow it down more. Some people would like to be called as, I'm a trustee of so-and-so organization, mm-hmm. I'm a chairman of this.
Yes,
this
president.
Mom. I'm a president, I'm a secretary of this
And you can see Islamic the way they express, yeah.
And if you do not use those titles as if like you've caused an offense to them.
I understand the importance of identifying oneself. So someone should say who he is, but then we're saying someone constantly mentioning the titles, or they just simply someone didn't call in certain
titles. I mean, in
titles.
Professional capacity, yeah. Of course, they're due to professional identification. We're not talking about that.
No.
We're talking about just merely making, like if it's a group of a gathering of friends or just parties, you know, the annual dinners and so on and so, continuously mentioning the fact.
We have another problem. We have another which is very important that we need to mention, that we have in some cultures, especially our Bangladeshi cultures, we have, if someone are not taken to the stages, then they feel really offended.
If my name hasn't been mentioned.
My name hasn't been mentioned. Or maybe if the name is not mentioned on top of the poster, then you see there's a huge problems can come. Poster aman nam tole dilay sun, tan nam ofre dilay sun. People start even fighting over that. So that can be a sign of, again, that doesn't mean that someone shouldn't give a person's due right and due respect. That should be given.
If it deserves.
Yeah. Yes, if someone deserves. Mm. But again, the other person must not be also offended just because that happened. Also, we find the people who might have the problem of excessive love for fame and status and authority, they continuously mention the weak sides of other people, weaknesses of other people. Or this man is like this, this person is that, this group is that, this organization is that. So they keep on saying bad things about others to prove that he is better.
I mean, put it in
an indirect way.
Yeah, but put it in this way, as if I'm doing, it's the only way of doing it.
And I'm doing it better than anybody else. Yeah. So if someone has that notion of continuously speaking negative things about others, individuals or people or groups or societies, then that can be a symptom of excessive love for fame and authority, which is again considered as diseased in Islam, hubbul jahi wa sulta, as scholars said. Also, if someone a person who loves to be only in public
domain,
like in TV, like in a big conference, he wouldn't go to a masjid, like a small program, to give a nasiha or talk. He just wants to be in big events. So again, that can be a problem. Some people, I found some people that if you don't take them to khutbah or big seminars or conference, then they wouldn't go, unless a big thing. But if it's a small event or small or private something, they would not prefer maybe.
And I think it applies not only to the dini aspect. In worldly matters, we
exactly
also
see, yes.
If it's a gathering,
I'm saying that because I come from the background.
No, that's very true. Yeah. I'm just making it a balanced. I mean, not only related to the religious figures, because we've seen with worldly attributes and invitation. If the invitation does not consist of quite a limited number of people.
I know people, unfortunately, they say, I don't do anything unless I have an interest of money. He said, if there is even like £1, I'll do it. Or some people, they say, I wouldn't do anything unless there is a desire, human desire, like fame. that if there is something like that, then
The other word we can put in today's common term, if there is no media publicity about it, if there is no cameras there, if there is no news reports there,
then they would feel like worthless.
Worthless to even go to be in that the program.
So where does then al-ikhlas goes? Where does the sincerity, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes?
And more than sincerity as well, when we say that we're part of such and such organization because we want to benefit the society, we want to benefit the humankind, but the very core of that benefit, when you need to have that sort of attendance, you would not attend just merely because there is no media or there is no sort of publicity in place.
That's right. So these kind of symptoms, if it appear, then we need to know that we have to work on that in order to get rid of these diseases.
So these are the signs.
Yes, signs. But obviously there are more, but these are just some of the primary signs. Now, the way we just get rid of them, number one, we have to nurture our faith on the importance of al-ikhlas al-ubudiyyah lillah. A scholar in Jama'at al-Azhar, he was Grand Sheikh or Grand Imam of al-Azhar, Sheikh Abdul Halim Mahmud, rahimahullah, once asked, what is the meaning of Islam? He said, al-Islam ma'anahu al-ikhlas al-ubudiyyah lillah. He said that worshipping one creator sincerely means al-Islam. This is the meaning of Islam as he defined Dr. Sheikh Abdul Halim Mahmud, rahimahullah. Also, we need to nurture our ego, that we need to learn how to digest our ego, lower it from the early age. And most importantly, we have to be very careful when it comes to praising.
Before I move into the praising, there's this good point you've mentioned about ego. Do we not need to learn and accept that we will not be always successful? There might be someone else who will be more knowledgeable than me.
Definitely.
I mean, who will be more successful than me, who will be more prominent than me, and who might be more famous than me.
Definitely there would be. Definitely. No matter how famous you become in this world, believe me, there will be people who wouldn't know you.
Correct.
There will be people that wouldn't know you. So we cannot be absolutely famous. Even some of the most famous people, you go and speak to some people from that some same field, They don't
recognize me. Yeah.
So it's not something that you can achieve fully. And this is the reason why our scholars, predecessors, when they wanted to keep themselves hidden, like unknown, for religious reason, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them famous in this world. And I know some of the scholars that don't want to be famous, some of the ulama, but they're so famous that people look for them and search for them to find where they are.
Now, just to add a little bit there, now, yes, those scholars, those ulama, or those people who are du'at and so on, they might not have the intention to become famous. We have to understand this. However,
Allah,
if they don't want intention, now, if their work demands them to be in public eye, for instance, seminars, halaqa, khutbah, conferences.
Yeah.
So even they don't want to be in the limelight, but because of what Allah has gifted or blessed them with, it's just the position they have to be within that framework to give the dawah.
So the bottom line is that we must not desire that fame. But if it does come, then this is a ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
So it's the intention that we need to prioritize.
And when we work sincerely for anything, not because of money or fame, then we see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He compensate. He gives these things in exchange. So as I said, some of the scholars, I want to mention a scholar's name, Sheikh Muhammad Mutawalli al-Sha'rawi. I've heard of his name. He was someone considered as father of the all Egyptian, or the Egyptian nation, or non-Egyptian, but most importantly, the Arab and Muslim world. Muhammad Mutawalli al-Sha'rawi was someone who was so beloved that people would remember and talk about him almost on a daily basis. If you go to Egypt, you can see that.
Actually in Egypt, but in the Middle East, in the Muslim world, he was very highly spoken about.
Mutawalli al-Sha'rawi was given the opportunity to be the religious minister of Egypt. But he disagreed with certain things and he gave up that role. But he was still respected and taken as high-ranking scholar. Not only that, also Mutawalli al-Sha'rawi, I want to mention one incident and that would give us a good lesson. He was, once after he came out of one of his lessons, some of the students, they lifted his vehicle, his car.
Lifted his vehicle?
Lifted, because out of the excessive love.
Okay.
So the students gathered and they said, we love the Sheikh. And they just, many of them, they came together and they lifted the car out of the love. Muhammad Mutawalli al-Sha'rawi, because he was someone really beloved by people. Even starting from the ulama, the high-ranking scholars, to the complete laymen, everyone, they respected him. So Muhammad Mutawalli al-Sha'rawi, as he was on his car, he felt something really different in himself. He said, you know, I'm someone respected, I'm someone honored. As soon as he felt, he said, I need to treat this problem instantly. So he told his driver, park the car when a masjid came. So next to a masjid, he said, park the car. He entered into the masjid. He was inside the mosque for a while. The driver was waiting. The sheikh doesn't come back. He doesn't return. Then he decided to go into the masjid to see what sheikh's doing. Then he saw the sheikh was cleaning the toilets. He was going to the wudu area, bathroom. He brings the water and he cleans the toilets. He was doing that for quite a long time. Driver was surprised and shocked. He was like, how can you do that, sheikh? I thought you're praying salah, maybe you're doing nafal. He said, no. People wanted to raise my, you know, status and fame, and they wanted to raise me, but I wanted to lower myself. So this is the reason why I did this. And no wonder people like him was so beloved by people. He's like the father for all, you know, Egyptian and also, as I said, Muslim in the Middle East.
So it's like fighting with your own nafs.
A nafs, desire, ego itself. So we cannot let it go over the right things, over the correct and fair and just matters.
Now, that connects with me to the other element of the question here is, we know certain times someone might have done some sort of favor that we have to be very thankful.
Mm-hmm.
Now, with that thankful and gratitude to that particular person who has done the favor,
mm-hmm.
Now, my question would be, we know that if I praise him, he would like it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, as a Muslim, I should always be concerned about the welfare of another Muslim, not only Muslim, yes, but even a brother in faith or even non-faith. Now, if I know by me thanking him or praising about his favor would make him someone, make him some sort of, give him some sort of happiness, should I at that point not be praising in front of him so that he does not fall into the
you
trap?
You see, we find statements of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam which actually says things about not to praise anybody excessively, especially in front of that person, avoiding the excessive praising.
Because this is another element that we see in society that excessive praise is there.
But at the same time, we find statements which suggest that Sahaba were praised, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was praised, even Hassan ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu was a personal poet of the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he praised the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in many occasions, and he has got shi'r, poems, poetries which praise Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like وَأَحْسَنُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَرَقَطْتُ عَيْنِي, you know, nobody has seen anyone like you, you know, the poem goes on and on, but it depends who we are praising. We have to be very careful. If someone who is understanding and it will not affect his iman, his religious understanding, then it's okay to praise. But again, it's always good to be moderate.
Anything excessive, we know is very harmful.
Yeah, it can be bad. But if we know this, if we praise someone and that can affect someone's religious status, then it's better probably to avoid and do in such a way, that in a light way, which helps him to be in the right position.
And just to touch upon that, when you said about praises about Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we also see the other element, even in today's world, when we see a lot of poems have been written, but sometimes that excessive praises even sometimes leads to shirk.
Yeah, that can, people can go out of the limit.
Exaggerate the Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam status and equate it to na'udhu billah, to
the level of Allah. Yes, this is the reason why Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, لا تطروني كما أطرأت النصارى عيسى بن مريم. He said, don't praise me or don't love me in such a way, just the way Christians loved the Holy Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him. They took him out of the human being or the manhood to be part of the God's family. This is due to the love, excessive love.
So that's kind of an element of shirk.
But this kind of love again is prohibited. So praising someone again, it's okay. Some people say, as soon as you pray, oh, don't praise me, they get really offended.
Yeah.
That's not also right.
In moderation.
In moderation, if someone praises, then that's okay. But we should avoid excessive praising. Although some people, they love to be praised. I know.
It's a human desire.
Yes.
So we just have to keep a check and balance on our
desires. Some people, they don't do anything unless you praise them. Have you seen?
There are people,
unless you say you're the best person, you do this, you're very talented.
Or you're known to be
so-and-so. Then he'll move on and he'll do
that. May Allah give us. And I think we are first to correct our own self. I'm first to correct my own self before even I say it to anyone else. Just to now, obviously, we're coming towards the end of the program. We know it's holiday season is upon us. a lot of people have finalized or going to finalize their trips abroad and so on and so forth, whether it be local, whether it be national or even international trips. Now, one of the other aspects I would like to a little bit touch upon is some children would say, we've been to Harams or Haramain quite often. So they might say, not to, because, you know, parents might have the desire to take the children to Umrah a lot or even Hajj seasons, if it's a holiday season. Now, I just wanted to bring about, there's a new phenomenon that has started, obviously, recently, or is trying to become common, that Ziyarah to Masjid Al-Aqsa.
Al-Mubarak, yes.
Al-Mubarak. Now, I just wanted to briefly touch upon people who made their plans to go there or who haven't made the plan or contemplating on it, or in future, maybe during the winter holidays, Christmas holidays. What are the benefits of visiting Al-Aqsa. Masjid Al-Aqsa?
Excellent question. Now, Mubarak to the people, or Hani and Likul to everyone who plan or who has been or who have been to that holy land, sacred land, the city of Al-Quds, which is currently known as Jerusalem, but obviously the original name is Al-Quds. This is very important. Now, Al-Aqsa, Masjid Al-Aqsa is the third most holiest and sacred site in Islam. And many of us, we know it was our first Qibla.
Correct.
We used to pray towards, facing towards Al-Aqsa, which some Muslims don't know, unfortunately. And it is well planned by many people, especially those who invaded that holy land in 1948, especially the Zionists. They did everything to make that place forgetful and neglected by the Muslims. So regional and territorial conflicts, wars have been created within the Muslim world so that Muslims are busy within their own, within themselves, and forget.
I mean, just to balance as well, we as Muslims are not doing any favor to ourselves as well.
Exactly.
We are always created, constantly being divided. And
that's what I'm saying.
Fighting within ourselves.
Yes.
So conflicts, we have our own fault as well.
Yeah, conflicts within the Muslim world, again, it was kind of, yes, Muslims fought, and also, and when I say that, you know, people fall into one category probably, but however, that Masjid Al-Aqsa is an important place. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Noble Quran, in Surah Al-Isra, سُبْحَانَ الَّذِي أَسْرَى بِعَبْدِهِ لَيْلًا مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ الْأَقْصَى. So Allah the Almighty said, glory be to Allah, the one who's pure. He made his slave Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, gave him a miraculous journey, and he traveled from the holy land of Mecca to Masjid Al-Aqsa. And from there, he was ascended to the seventh sky. The story of Mi'raj that many of us know. So Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he was taken to Masjid Al-Aqsa, where he led and had been privileged to be the Imam of all the Prophets. And then he was ascended to the seventh sky. This was our Qibla. This is the first Qibla. This is a land which is considered to be a blessed land. الَّذِي بَارَكْنَا حَوْلَ, as Quran said. Not only blessed in spiritual or in the religious sense, but it's also the land is fertile, land is very productive, and uncountable amount of prophets were sent to a city of Al-Quds. Uncountable companions are buried, and the prophets and messengers are buried. Prophet Jesus, Prophet Moses, and many major prophets were sent to that land, the land of Palestine. Now, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked once by Abu Dharr al-Ghifari radiallahu anhu, a hadith mentioned in the book of Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi, where he said, O Prophet of Allah, Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu asked, O Messenger of Allah, which mosque was ever built first on this earth? So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-Masjid al-Haram, the Al-Haram Masjid in Mecca. Then he said, which masjid? Then he said, Al-Aqsa, Masjid Al-Aqsa. Then he said, what was the difference of time between them two? Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, 40 years. Now also Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that nobody should plan to go to a place just because of the virtues of that place, fadail of that place, apart from three lands. And then he said, Masjid Al-Haram in Mecca, Masjid Al-Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in Medina Al-Munawwara, and Masjid Al-Aqsa in Palestine. So we can go to a place because of a bigger jamaat, bigger congregation, to probably visit someone or to meet a scholar, that's fine. But just for the virtues of place, land, only a person can go to three places, only lands only. Masjid al-Haram in Mecca, Medina, and Al-Aqsa.
The Haramain and the Aqsa.
Exactly. Okay. And also Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he considered in a hadith on the authority of Maymuna, radiallahu anha, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, or she asked Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Aftina fi bayt al-Maqdis." Tell us something about the city of Al-Quds or Bayt al-Maqdis. He said, "Ardul Mahshar wal Manshar." It's a place where it's a place of gathering. It's a place of resurrection. Tuhu fasallu. Go there and pray salah. Fa inna salatan fi ka alfi salatin fi ghairihi. Because praying salah there, one rakah equivalent to 1,000 rakats. So one salah is 1,000 salah. And so hadith continues. We don't want to go. But Masjid al-Aqsa, it's one of the holy sites for Muslims, and we cannot forget. We must put in our hearts and minds.
And just to conclude, I know we are very short of our time, and inshallah, some other day with another new topic, maybe we can discuss more about it in detail. But just to reiterate and just to make a little bit of emphasis on the fact that there might be a lot of issues that might be going around it. But as Muslim, it is an article of our faith that we have to believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, and Musa, peace be upon him, which means we do not treat whether our brothers in faith of Christianity or brothers who follow the Judaism faith, they are enemies, but rather they are Abrahamic brothers. We share the same faith.
Yes,
and we live together side by side, and we should not have any sort of hatred or any, hostility towards particular
Muslims. On a defensive mood, I believe, for many years, for decades, and especially when we talk about Al-Aqsa, then again we are on the defensive mode. So.
We should have a balanced approach. And if someone else does something wrong, you can't blame the whole of the faith
for committing this particular
crime. I think that's wrong.
Absolutely.
And I think we as Muslims, we know it better.
Absolutely wrong.
So we have to, and we should always have that unity. And I think Rasulullah engaging in constructive discussion, symposium, dialogues. And maybe, inshallah, we make dua that may Allah releases and reduces the suffering of the ummah.
Ameen, Ya Rabbil Alameen.
Thank you very much for joining so late at night and for your valuable thoughts. And inshallah, we look forward to meet you again in our next week episode.
It's my pleasure, and I hope Allah accept our efforts, and we have benefited, I hope.
Jazakallah khair. With this, my dear viewers, we have come to the conclusion of our tonight's discussion. We have been discussing our tonight's topic, which is human desires. We have discussed the different aspects of human desires. We have discussed our love and symptoms with regards to how we can treat the desires, the excessive desire that we have, which we fall into the trap of worldly matter of fame, name, whether it be wealth, whether it be position, leadership, and so on and so forth. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability, starting with myself first, to eradicate, to give up all of those diseases and that heart will acquire or the heart will desire to achieve. And the important aspect here, we need to also understand that one of the things that stops us from getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is this, the excessive desires and love for worldly matters, and which takes the precedency over akhirah, over the Quran and Sunnah. And we should always keep our intention in check and balance. And as Muslim, we should always remember, as a true believer, we should always be humble, and we should always be very down to earth, and at the same time, modest. With this, I conclude our tonight's discussion. And if you do have any suggestions or feedback, please feel free to email us at towardstheorigin@chsuk.tv. Until we meet again next week, till we meet again, سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. Thank you very much.
بارك الله فيكم.